Hello and welcome to this next in the series of talks about Tchaikovsky's Fourth Symphony. Today I'm going to be looking at the second and third movements. So let's dive straight in by just reminding ourselves what Tchaikovsky said about the second movement in his letter to Nadezhda von Meck. The second movement of the symphony expresses another aspect of sadness. This is that melancholy feeling which comes in the evening when, weary from one's toil, one sits alone with a book, but it falls from the hand. There come a whole host of memories. It is sad that so much is now in the past, albeit pleasant to recall one's youth. Both regretting the past and yet not wishing to begin life over again. Life is wearisome. It is pleasant to rest and look around. Memories abound. Happy moments when the young blood boiled and life was satisfying. There are also painful memories, irreconcilable losses. All this is now somewhere far distant. It is both sad, yet somehow sweet, to be immersed in the past. So that's his rather poetic letter. Before we listen to the movement, I'd like to just show you an overview of the whole thing. And here we are. Now, I've rather fancifully given it the title Sing Us One of the Old Songs. That's from the Old Testament. But I've done that because Tchaikovsky himself calls this movement a canzona, a song. And that is really what it is. It's an evocation of a sort of folk tune. Tchaikovsky did use real folk tunes. In fact, in the last movement of this symphony, he quotes another a folk tune. But he also had the gift of writing melodies that sound as if they've been around forever. And this movement is one of those melodies. So I've analysed it as if it is just a simple song with verses and choruses. The overall structure of the movement is a simple ternary form, so A, B, A. And this is how it breaks up. In the first A section, we're in B-flat minor. We have a verse of the song. It's repeated. And then we have the chorus or the refrain. We have the third verse of the song and the chorus comes in again. Then we have a sort of middle section, the B section, where we go into the dominant key, F major. And essentially what Tchaikovsky does in this section is he plays the same 8-bar melody or phrase 9 times. Starts in F major twice, then 3 times we have it in A flat major, then it goes back to F major, twice we hear it in D flat, which sort of balances out the movement to A flat, and then the 9th phrase is actually extended, it's longer than 8 bars, and that transitions us back to B flat minor for the repeat of the A section. As you can see, this is shorter than the first A section. We just have a verse, a chorus, one more verse, and then a short coda. So let's listen to the second movement. The PDF will go past your eyes as it plays, and if there's anything to say while the music's playing, I'll say it. So that was verse 1, solo oboe, 4 bars, 4 bars, 4 bars, 8 bars. For all the cellists out there, this is just a delight to play. The end of verse 2, and here's the refrain. Just ask yourself, what key is this in? feels modal to me. Now this is very Tchaikovskyan. The ease with which he just moves around these chords is amazing. Pedal cues going. Taking us back to B flat minor and the third verse. Now this is the third time we've heard this tune, but just look at the rhythm of it. It's entirely quavers. And the thing that makes it interesting is the articulation. If you were just to write out the rhythm of this, it would be quaver, 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 quaver. And here comes the chorus again. Like a chorus, because also it's got more orchestration. The orchestration is heavier, isn't it? So the verses are solo voices, and then it's like everybody joins in for the chorus. And all these wonderful changes of key, B major, D, F. Dotted rhythm, which you had in the first movement. There's our lovely Russian horn player. This tune's amazing, it's just basically four notes. And you can imagine yourself walking along just with this thing going around in your head like an earworm. Tune again in A flat. Lovely counter melody here. Matter bass back. Syncopations here. Everything's going down, semitones going down. This is the extended phrase. To the A section. Notice how the harmony is now on the wrong beat, as it were. That's the right beat, wrong beat. It's rather like it's limping. So this verse is a violin solo. Obviously it's all the first violins, but it's their solo. And then everybody joins in for the chorus. This chorus breaks down chorus has happened three times, and each time it works out differently. Just a little touch of G flat major. Another lovely passage for the cellos here. Going down. Takes us all the way down to a dominant in B flat minor with another semitone. Final verse, bassoon solo. This violin line is beautiful. So just an augmented sixth chord there with semitones leading onto the F. And so on to the third movement, the scherzo. This is what Tchaikovsky says about it in his letter. The third movement expresses no specific feeling. This is whimsical arabesques, vague images which can sweep past the imagination after drinking a little wine and feeling the first phases of intoxication. The spirit is neither cheerful nor sad, thinking about nothing in particular, giving free rein to the imagination, which somehow begins to paint strange pictures. Amid these memories, there suddenly comes a picture of drunken peasants and a street song. Then, somewhere in the distance, a military procession passes. These are completely incoherent images which sweep through the head as one falls asleep. They have nothing in common with reality. They are strange, wild, and incoherent. Again, a rather poetic description. And this is my overview of the movement. Now, I have called this talk Song and Dance, and I've described this movement as three dances. It's really important that I emphasise that calling this movement a dance movement is my idea, and the names of the dances are my names. Tchaikovsky does not call it a polka, a march and a gallop. I do. But I think it's a useful way of thinking about what's going on. And we must bear in mind that Tchaikovsky was an absolutely fabulous composer for the ballet. So if the second movement is a song, then this movement, the third movement, is a dance. Now, essentially, it's in a sort of arch form, not quite an arch form, because this bit doesn't get a second playing by itself. We start off with a sort of polka, which is the strings pizzicato. Then the winds play a march. The brass play a gallop, we get the polka back, and then in the coda we get snippets of all three dances. Now Tchaikovsky said about this movement that he'd written something that was entirely original, something of his own devising. And it's really hard to, I can't think of anything else that is quite like this. It's a sort of show-off piece for the orchestra in its various sections, string section, woodwind section, brass section. So in that respect, it may, you could say it's a forerunner of Britain's Young Person's Guide to the Orchestra, or even, stretching it a bit, the Bartok Concerto for Orchestra. Whatever, it is, of course, a delightful and charming movement, and it explains itself as it goes along. So let's have a listen to it, and once again, I'll have the PDF up, and if anything interesting occurs to me to say, I will say it. Hypo is a word that's used in modal music that means that the mode is working from dominant to dominant. It's a decorated pedal. This is this music from here, but now in B flat minor. Ternary feel here because we get back to the opening. Augmented sixth chord. Modulating sequence. And we're in A. Now I've called this a march. I suppose this could be the bit that Tchaikovsky is referring to as peasants in his letter. Doesn't really matter. Fragments of all the dancers thrown around. And we're back to the strings. Thank you. is our coda, playing with the keys, the three keys of the movement, F, D flat, and A major, sorry. Pedal. Little snippet of D flat. Back to F. Just a couple of things to say before we finish for this week. I just want to point out the tonal scheme of that third movement. It's very simple in the sections are very clear, F major, A major and D flat. Just want to say something which I hope is obvious, but they are all a major third away from each other. So F, major third up, A major. If you think of D flat enharmonically as C sharp, that's a major third up from A, and then D flat to F, another major third. So it's quite an elegant tonal scheme. It's one of the ways that you can divide the circle of keys up symmetrically, and that's what Tchaikovsky is doing. The other thing that I mentioned in the course of the performance was this idea of a hypo mode, H-Y-P-O, hypo. It's something that was used in medieval music to describe a piece where the melody went from dominant to dominant, rather than tonic to tonic. So let's just imagine D Dorian. So D, E, F, G, A, B, C, D. Normal Dorian mode, obviously the bottom note and the top note would be D, and the most important note in the middle would be the A. Now in a hyperdorian, the music would run from A to A, but the most important note in the middle would be D. Now sometimes these modes are called plagal modes. Now, if you think about the normal version, D to A is a fifth that way. And if you think about the hypo mode, got A on top and the D is the fifth below. So in one of them, there's a fifth above and one of them, there's a fifth below. It's not that important. Having just made a big thing about it, it's not that important. It's something to just be aware of. And possibly later in life when you're looking at medieval music, it's something that you'll remember. Anyway, that's that. Next time we'll be looking at the last movement, and then we will have finished Tchaikovsky's Fourth Symphony. See you then. Bye-bye.